Hi everyone, my name is Justin Odisho, and in this video, I'm going to be going over the basics of Photoshop. So I'm going to do it just as if I was over a friend's shoulder and I was showing them the program for the first time, so things like layouts, menus, and the basics of how to get started. So let's go to our desktop and open Adobe Photoshop CC 2017. If you still haven't upgraded, I'll leave a couple links in the description below on a video on what's new in this feature and if the subscription model and the new versions of CC are worth it, which I think they are. So when you open up Photoshop, what you'll be greeted with is this new starting menu. And here you can see all of your recent files that you've opened. So here's some PSDs, which are Photoshop documents that I've had open recently, and some photo files. You can view these in a grid or list mode, or you can see here on the left-hand side, you can start a new project or open a file. So although you do have all of these blank document presets to open, on the right-hand side here, you can see that you can fill in whatever parameters you want. So if you specifically need something to be a certain amount of pixels or a certain amount of inches, let's say you're creating a wallpaper for your desktop, then you can just type those in and create a size of your own. So I'll type in a 1920 by 1080 blank document. You also have the options of adjusting the resolution, pixels per inch, the color mode like red, green, blue, or CMYK if you're doing print work, or the contents of the blank document when you first start. Do you want to start off white, black, or with a background color? I'll just leave it all kind of default. And then if you press create, Photoshop will open up that new blank document and you can see here untitled one is the tab. I'm also going to open a photo just to show you the difference. So you can always go to the top menu and go to file and either create a new document or press open. This doesn't close your current thing. So if I press open and I browse through my desktop or computer and I find a photo that I want to open or other file, you can see that this is a camera raw file, which many cameras allow you to shoot in raw mode, and Photoshop has a plugin that's built in that will open up called Camera Raw. This just allows you to adjust things like the exposure, contrast, highlights, white balance, and all those simple adjustments that are built into the camera. And this is a very powerful tool in its own, but I'm just going to open the image as is and continue in Photoshop. So now I have my photo open, which you can see here, and I can switch to the different tabs that I have open. So here's that untitled one blank document that we still have open. So let's work on the photo layer to give you guys an example of what tools you have available in Photoshop. So then one of the most important menus as we look around is this one right here that's usually in the bottom right corner. It's called Layers. Now before I go further breaking down all these different menus and panels that are available, you do want to note that in the top menu bar where you have all these different options like File, Edit, and all that, there's one called Window, and under the Workspace panel, you can adjust to reset to the essentials because they have different preset workspaces which open up different panels depending on the workflow that you're trying to do. So if you press reset essentials, it should reset things to this layout here so we are all on the same page. So as I was saying, you have the layers panel, and this is one of the most important things because Photoshop works in layers. So when I have a photo open, Photoshop will make it the background layer by default. It's locked, which means you can't adjust it. But if you could double click on this and press OK, then you'll see a few options become available to begin editing. So you have the visibility of the layer, which is indicated by this eyeball, which means you can make it visible or not visible. Whenever something is not visible or transparent in Photoshop, it'll be represented by this checkerboard pattern. On top of that, you have blending modes, which are the way that different layers blend together. This is just set to normal. And you also have opacities. So this is 100%, and you can see as I lower it, things start to get more transparent. So keep that in mind as you consider how we're going to blend different things together. Now you can also create new layers. You also should see all these different smaller symbols, which are most all just shortcuts for doing different things. So don't get too confused by them. They're just shortcuts when you want them. Like this one here is the create new layer shortcut. And when I click it, it'll add a new layer on top that I can begin working on and doing different things on. Alternatively, you always have the option to go up to your top menu, and if you go to Layer, go to New Layer, you can create new layers through this pop-up If you want, you can name them certain things for organization purposes and press OK, and you should see that as well. Whenever you double click on this, you should be able to adjust layer names if you want. Now, scaling back from just looking at the layers panel, you see that there's all types of different panels, and they each display different types of information. You have the adjustments panel, which just gives you shortcut access to all the different type of adjustments you can create. You have different libraries, which is linked up to your Creative Cloud membership, where you can save certain color swatches or brushes or textures and things like that. And then you have whatever else is active for your current workspace. Just because these are up right now doesn't mean these are the only ones that Photoshop has. So this is like the history. This is everything that's been done to this layer so far since we opened it. And you can actually step backward or forward through these steps. However, if you go to Window, you see that there's so many different menus that aren't even active right now, and they all have their different use and are related to different tools. So you can see this top menu bar is going to have all different types of options for you to open up windows, change the view of things, use filters, select different things, go to your typing tools, create new layers and things like that, apply image adjustments, or edit things and undo things, or just go to File, New, and Open, and all that. This is a very important menu, the top menu bar. Aside from all the panels and the top menu bar, you also have the left-hand side toolbar. This is where all of your tools reside and also your color picker. So each one of these tools does a different thing. You have things like the paintbrush, the lasso tool, which lets you select things, gradient tools, eraser tools, text and typing tools, which create new text layers. And you have your foreground and background color, which by default is black and white. But if you double click on them, you can open up the color picker, which lets you pick different colors. At the very bottom screen, you'll just see a couple pieces of information, but a really key one here is the view percentage. So right now it's scaled at 25% because this image happened to be pretty large, whereas the window and resolution of my screen is not large enough to hold it. So it's at 25% to fit. However, you can type things in here like 100%, and this is actually the true size of it. You can use your laptop or computer's trackpad to scroll back on the view, or you can go to View and adjust things to be either 100% actual size or fit on screen or zoom in and zoom out. And of course, there's shortcuts for all of these things as well, which I highly recommend. If you're learning, try to learn the shortcuts and work with the shortcuts, because that's how you're actually going to want to work in the future. So now that you have a general idea of the layout of things and where everything is, let's do a couple basic edits on this photo. So let's say you wanted to adjust the colors. Here's where you'd work with adjustment layers. So although you can highlight your photo's layer and go to Image, Adjustments, and have access to all these different adjustments like contrast and color, a smarter and more non-destructive way to work on things, which just means that you have more flexibility of changing things and things are not permanent, is by working with adjustment layers. So here you can go to Layer, New Adjustment Layer, and find all those same adjustments. So let's say I wanted to add a curves adjustment layer. So I'll go to New Adjustment Layer, Curves, and then I can name it if I prefer. If you want to be organized, but I'll just keep it at Curves 1, which is the default name, and press OK. You'll see that it'll create that adjustment layer over top of my currently highlighted layer. But at the moment, it's not doing anything because we haven't input any values into it. Here's where you can see the Properties menu changes. So I actually like to drag this out and kind of keep it as its own standalone pop-up window to work with, and I'll make it a bit bigger to work with. So this is just one example of an adjustment in Photoshop. This is a pretty powerful color adjusting tool called Curves. So this line represents the dark points and the highlights of the photo, and you can click and drag points on this to darken or highlight things. And you can switch to different color channels like red, green, and blue, and adjust those individually to boost colors in certain areas and create different color effects. I have whole separate tutorials on this, as I do with most other tools and effects on my channel. So remember, this is just basic, and you can go to my channel and check out each individual effect broke down into steps in separate videos. Once I've edited the colors how I wanted, I can either minimize the window or drag it into one of these panels for easier access. Now, another thing you're gonna see when you're working with certain layers like adjustment layers is they're represented by this little circle, which means adjustment layer, and then this white box, and this is a layer mask. You see nothing white is actually showing up. That's because this represents what portions of the photo are visible or not. So when you have white, that means it's visible. However, when you paint on it in black, that means it's gonna hide it. So if I didn't want this adjustment layer to show on a certain portion of this, I could grab my paintbrush tool. I could make sure black is my foreground color that's active. I could go up to this top menu, which changes based on whatever tool you're working with to give you the options for that tool. And I could choose a brush, one of these default brushes, lower the size, softness, or hardness of it, and paint black on the layer mask, and you see that hides whatever's on this layer. That's because this layer mask is telling things to be hidden when they're black and show when they're white. But I'm gonna undo that with Command Z or Edit Undo, which is gonna be one of your most used tools, so get familiar with that one. Remember, you have the history panel here, so whenever I press Command Z, it'll go backward or forward once, or if I press Option Command Z, it'll keep going backward up to a certain amount of steps. By default, I believe it's 50. So let's say I wanted to add some text to this photo. If I go to my text tool, you'll see this top menu will change to reflect the options that I now have. So I can choose the font, the size of the font, the alignment, pretty basic text editing tools that you might be familiar with from many programs. When you click, it'll automatically create a new text layer and start blinking on the cursor to allow you to type. So I can type hello, I can click and highlight the text, I can enlarge it, and I can click this move tool to move things around. You can see the text wrote out in black because that's what my current foreground color was. But if I go back to my type tool and I highlight things, I can switch to my background color, which was white. I can make that my foreground color, and now the text is white. You also have a whole host of transformation options on any photo or layer if you go to Edit, Transform. So here you'll have options to scale, rotate, or flip things around, no matter what type of layer they are. If you hold Shift while you're scaling, it'll make sure to scale in proportion. So that's another way to adjust the size of things. Whenever you hover over a tool, if you hover long enough, Photoshop should tell you what the name of the tool is and the shortcut to get to it. So that could help you out when you're learning. So you can see the Move tool is the Move tool, and I can press V to activate it on my keyboard rather than clicking it. Also, whenever you click and hold down on any tool, you can see the tools that are behind it or in that same family of tools. You can see that each of these tools has that little arrow on it, which indicates that there's more tools stacked underneath it. So if I click and hold here, I can see I have the rectangular marquee selection tool, or I also have the elliptical or single row, and so on. So going back to the idea of blending modes that I mentioned earlier, now that we finally have a couple things to blend together, let's see what happens if we try to blend this text. So this is what it looks like on normal. However, you see we have all these subtractive and additive blending modes, which are all just mathematically based on different color codes and all that, and you'll learn how they operate the more you practice them. But if I press overlay, you could see it will overlay the different colors and mix them in that way, or something like exclusion or subtract, and you'll see that they all have different results. Additionally, I can lower the opacity of this, and you can see how it begins to become more transparent and see-through. So what you can also see is that the layers work kind of like from a top-down perspective. So if you're imagining a sandwich, the top layers are the top piece of bread, and the bottom layers are at the bottom. So anything that you put on top is going to show in front of whatever's behind it. So now let's say you want to save your creation. Here you can go to File, Save, and if you haven't saved it before, it'll pull up the Save As menu. Alternatively, I usually just go to File, Save As to be safe. So here I can save it as a .psd or a Photoshop format document, which is what it's prompting me to do. which means that it saves with layers intact. So when I open it back up, I'll see all of these layers again, and I can edit things, and it'll be flexible for me to edit. However, it's not a flat image for you to share. So after you save it as a Photoshop document, if you know you want to continue working on it, you then have the option to save it as a JPEG or PNG file or all these different formats depending on the way that you want to share it. Typically, for photos, a JPEG or PNG will do fine. If you're ever working on an object that has transparency in it, you're going to want to save it as a PNG so that things remain transparent. So after you save it, then it'll show up on your desktop and you'll have created your new photo file or creation that you wanted to create. Alternatively, if things are too big or this isn't the size that you wanted to save it in, you can go to Image, Image Size, and here's where you can choose what size you want to scale your image to be. So out of the camera raw, it's pretty large, 5,000 by 3,000 pixels, and I can scale it down to be 1920 by 1280 if that's the size that I wanted it to be in the first place. So that's how you edit the size of your image. And once you save things, you can close or keep the document open. So let's close this, and here we are back at our blank document that we had opened earlier. So when you're talking about working with blank documents, here's where you can either drag photos in here. You could just directly drag JPEGs or photos from your desktop into this canvas, or you could build and generate graphics of your own using Photoshop's preset tools. So you have things like the paintbrush tool, which allow you to paint and then maybe add text on top of it. So I could create a new layer, and on this empty transparent layer, I could go to my gradient tool and I could choose a colorful gradient and add that for me to work with. Whenever you're working on a layer, you also have the option to apply filters onto it. So you could apply filters onto your photo layers or onto your graphics. So you have all types of different filters like blurring, distorting, adding noise, pixelating, rendering different graphics like clouds, stylize, all that. Again, I have separate tutorials using many of these more specifically. And you could use blending modes to create graphic creations of your own. I know this doesn't look like quite of a masterpiece, but you understand the basics. So you have all these tools available for you to use in Photoshop, all these menus, and my best advice is just take it easy one step at a time. Open up your photos, play around with them, and whenever you're trying to figure out how to do something, Adobe has a great section where you can search what a specific tool does if you don't know what it does. Or you can go on YouTube and find channels or people like myself where you can search on my channel specific things like how to do this or how to do that and see a video walking you through it. And slowly by slowly, you'll be able to piece together all these different tools in Photoshop until you build a knowledge and strength and are comfortable with the program. So that's the very basics here. Definitely check out my playlist and subscribe and follow me on social media at Justin Odishow on Facebook, Instagram, Twitter to keep in touch and use all these resources in front of you to learn the program, learn what you need to do, and hopefully this video gave you a good start. Definitely subscribe to my channel here on YouTube. It's free to do. You can check out all of my previous tutorials, and I've always got more to come. Again, if you haven't gotten the latest version yet, then check the description below for a few more videos about what's new in the latest version and why I think it's worth it to get. And to wrap things up here, thank you guys so much for watching, and I'll see you next time.